Please stand as we sing, This Is the Day.
I don't think the mic is on. Test. Good morning, my name is Finn Noel and today is Scout Sunday. We offer our condolences to the family of Bruce Hayes who passed away Friday. Our church custodians, Yin and Naya, say thank you for our contribution to Naya at her sister's death. The Council on Ministries will meet today from 4 to 6 in the Fellowship Hall. Very important meeting. Jam Kids will begin meeting from 3 to 5 in the children's basement. Pre-order your chickens due today. Pickup will be next Saturday, February 27th, between 12 to 2 p.m. $8 per quart or $30 per gallon. Contact Dean Natale. Joy Kids will meet today in the CFC from 3 to 5. The Women's Ministry at Center will be selling chicken pies on March 6th. They will be $11 each. Contact Sydney May to place your order. American Heritage Girls will have their All Seasons consignment sale March 19th and 20th. This raises money for activities and retreats. Are there any other announcements? Oh, can you please pick up one of these on your way out?
Please bow your heads while we pray. Thank you, God, for this day, and thank you for everything you do. Thank you for letting all the scouts and IHJ be here today, and thank you for letting everyone help out who did. And in your name we pray, amen.
Welcome to Center.
Color Guard, attention. Color Guard, forward march. Color Guard, halt, face. Color Guard, present the colors. Okay, wait. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Scouters and Scouts, right hand salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Two. Scouters and Scouts, right hand salute. On my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country, obey the Scout law, help other people at all times, keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight. Two.
As an American Heritage girl, I promise to love God, cherish my family, honor my country, and serve in my community. Two.
Color Guard, post the colors. Color Guard, face. Color Guard, forward march. Color guard dismissed.
As scouts, we like to stay busy. This pandemic has challenged us, but Center Church's scouting and AHG members have continued to serve our community and country. Please enjoy these pictures that capture some of our memories. A huge thank you to Elizabeth Kratz for creating this slideshow. Thank you.
Will the children please come up? This is a ring. Some rings might remind us of an important promise. Do any of your parents have wedding rings? Wedding rings are very special things. On the day of their wedding, the people getting married promise to love each other forever, and the ring reminds them of that promise. People make promises on their wedding days and at other times too. We all make promises, like when we promise our parents we'll clean up our toys after we play. Promises are important, but sometimes we don't keep them. But God, He always keeps His promises. Our Bible lesson today is about a promise God made to a man named Noah. You might know about Noah's ark. Do you know who Noah was?
A man that builded a boat.
Tell her. Shout it out.
The person that built the ark.
Okay. You can just yell it out if you want to.
The person who made a boat and then put animals like the animals.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Whole story right there. After the flood waters went down, God made a promise to Noah. He promised Noah that he would never again destroy the whole earth with the flood. Then he put a rainbow in the sky and said to Noah, "I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the promise between me and all life on earth." God said the rainbow would remind us of the promise that He made. Let's see a little rainbow science experiment now. God's rainbow was in the sky and a reminder that He always keeps His promises. The Bible says that no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. 2 Corinthians 1:20. The next time you see a rainbow, remember the promise God made to Noah. And remember that just as God kept that promise, He keeps all of His promises to you. 2. Bow your heads and let's pray. Dear God, we were thankful that you keep your promises. Help us to keep our promises too. In Jesus' name, amen. We will not be having children's church today. You may be seated. Well, you're already seated.
Now, this has certainly been a blessing with all our young people, hadn't it? We're just so, and you know, these symbolize so many, yes, and just think of all the adults that help in these great ministries, folks. Could we just thank the Lord for them? Thank you all so much. We'll go to the Lord in prayer and lift up some needs that we need to remember. Larry Wilson, that's Tina's dad, he came home from the hospital this week. We need to remember Gene Combs, he lost his mother about 2 weeks ago. We need to remember Dean Slabach. He's going for some more cancer treatments and some physician's appointments this week. So let's remember Dean in your prayers, as well as Rod Laughlin as he continues his treatments. Tony Leonard, he had some heart procedure done. We need to remember him. Certainly we want to remember Gavin Hill and pray for him as he's in this battle with his cancer as well. If you have a need, just raise your hand so we can pray for you. All right. Any others? Okay. All right. Okay. All right, then let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for coming into our presence. We're honored, Lord, that you're here. You've said where two or more gathered in your name, there you are in the midst. God, we thank you for the gift of the leadership of these scouting units, these men and women that stepped up to lead our young people. God, we thank you for our young people that are walking with you, and they've come today to share their ministry with us, and we thank you for them. We pray your blessings upon them. We pray your protection over them from ski trips to riding horses to canoeing, whatever they do. And God, may you smile upon them and give them favor and bless them and use them to reach other young people for you. And Lord, I pray that you'd be with Gene and bless him and his family and comfort them at this time of the loss. We pray, God, that you'd be with Gavin and surround him with your strength and lift him up, give him your courage. We pray for healing of his body, and we pray for guidance for the physicians that are working with Rod and Dean even now, and we pray for for successful treatments that they're going to be going through. And God, we just pray you'd continue to bless Tony and help him to get stronger as well. And God, we pray for others that have lost loved ones and their hearts are heavy today. And we just thank you for all that you say and do for us. Bless and keep us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus is
stand as we sing Alleluia.
Six days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took out a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected, "Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages." He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. "Leave her alone," Jesus replied. "It was intended that she would save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Logan. We appreciate you. Today I want to talk a little bit about temptation. This is the 40 days journey, a couple of days gone now, leading us through Lent all the way to Easter. We began that journey back at this past Wednesday night at Ash Wednesday service. And what a service we had. Lynn Upchurch preached for us and our young people sang for us. And really, it was really a special night. And I think God blessed us. And I want to talk a little bit then about our journey, our wilderness journey. Now, that can come in different fashions for every single one of us. Temptations is different for every single one of us. You know, what tempts me may not tempt you, and what tempts you may not bother me, but temptation is something that's a part of the human condition, and we all have to be on our guard. In fact, Paul wrote to the Corinthians, he said, if you think you're above temptation, basically he said, take heed lest you fall into temptation. See, we have to be on our guard constantly. I want to read to you a text from Matthew's Gospel, the fourth chapter this morning, just a little bit of it. Hear the word of the Lord. Would you stand in reverence for the reading of God's word? Matthew chapter 4, "Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, 'If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread.' And Jesus answered, 'It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" That's key. You might want to underline that. "Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. 'If you're the Son of God,' he said, 'throw yourself down, for it's written, he'll command his angels concerning you, and they'll lift you up in their hands, and that you will not strike your foot against a stone.' Jesus answered him, 'It's also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test.' But again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and its splendor. 'All this I'll give you,' he said, 'if you'll bow down and worship me.' And Jesus said to him, 'Away from me, Satan, for it's written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only.' Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended to him." This is the word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. God, we just thank you that we come to this place that is indeed holy ground. This is the place today that you've selected to meet with us, and we thank you. God, thank you for using our young people today to remind us of life and remind us of joy. And they reminded us with there been a sense of an ordinary world as they showed us these slides of all the things that they've done and accomplished this past year. Lord, likewise speak afresh to us through your word. Teach us. And I'm so thankful that as I stand here today, your prophet Isaiah said long ago that your word wouldn't return to you void. So I thank you that I know you're going to accomplish far more than I can ever imagine. And we're going to praise you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And you can be seated. Now Jesus is taken out into the wilderness, this barren place, and he lives for some 40 days and 40 nights, apparently fasting, praying. You know, this sidebar is if the Lord needed that much time to pray and to get apart from the crowds, how much more do you need to get away from the crowds as well? His ministry would begin right after this point and move him to the cross 2.5-3 years later. Powerful thought. He begins with the Lord in that ministry. And that's important for us. In fact, it began with his baptism. He had just been baptized. If you'll look at the scriptures, then we read the account of him going to be baptized. This is a high mark for him, for his baptism. That's a great thing that happens in the life of the church. You join the church, you're basically saying to everybody, hey, I'm trusting the Lord. He's my Savior. I'm walking with Him. And we're kind of staking our claim. Look, you can see, and I need your help and your support. We're going to be recognizing folks at the end of the service that are basically saying, hey, I'm already a Christian. I'm thankful for that. And I'm joining this body of believers here at Center. What a marvelous thing it is. That's a pretty important step for somebody, I think. And it was an important step with Jesus' ministry as well. Satan will often attack us at those high moments in our life. It's not reserved just for the high moments, but those are great times when he can move and attack us. Why? Because we feel invincible. We feel like I'm top of the world. I've accomplished something great. And then he kind of moves in and speaks to you and can begin to pull you away. Charles Spurgeon had preached a great sermon one time. After he got through preaching the sermon, he was at the door greeting people, and there was a lady came up to him, and she said, that was a wonderful sermon you preached. He said, the devil's already told me that before I stepped off the platform today. It's a dangerous place when you feel spiritually high, because then Satan can come along because your guard is down. It can also come to you when you're low. Jesus had been in the wilderness for some 40 days when Satan came to him again and began to tempt him and to try to work on him. Because he was tired, he was hungry, probably wanting to be with other people. He'd been isolated for that period of time. So you also got to be careful in the high moments, and you got to be careful in the low moments. When you're tired, boy, that's when he can come and work on you, can he? And he can rob you. He can rob you of your vision. I was thinking this morning, I'm not a morning person, and I was thinking about things, and I was thinking about, we've got an important meeting after a while. We're going to come and have a dream session with the Council on Ministries, and we're going to dream a dream, hopefully, about where God's taking us as a church. And I was thinking about all that this morning, and I thought, gosh, I don't want to go to that meeting. And I am not a morning person. I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to see you. And I mean, I just, let me alone. Let me have my piece of sausage and my eggs and everything will be okay. But just let it go, okay? Some people's not that way. My friends, listen. You have to be on guard constantly. Satan come to him and said, hey, you see this bread right here? These rocks? The rocks were limestone. It looked very similar to baked bread. And he said to him, hey, you speak to that right there and it can become bread to you. You can do that. Jesus is already hungry. Man, that must have made him begin to think about it. You know, I could start talking to y'all about country-style steak and green beans and mashed potatoes and deviled eggs and good sweet tea, that kind of things in a little bit. Some of you start getting salivating, wouldn't you? Some of you started doing that now, good old fried chicken. Well, you know, Jesus was tired. He was hungry. Satan said, hey, look at those rocks. He was tempting him. And what did Jesus say? Man can't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That's what man needs. Then Satan said, oh, okay. Let me show you something else. Took him up on top of the high point in the temple. Looked out over the Kedron Valley, some 400 feet down below the wall, the highest point at the temple's courts. And looked, turned him around and looked out through there, that great valley, and said, look at that. You could throw yourself off of that, and the Lord would take care of you. He'd protect you. What was he appealing to? He was appealing to the sense of how Jesus came to this world to reach people. That was his passion. See, Satan knows that. He knows what your passion is. He knows all about you. And he can use your passion to twist it for his own purpose. So what was he telling him to do? Jump down off of that. People will follow you. They'll be surprised at what you're doing. Can you imagine somebody jumping off the top of this building and we're all out there? And we'd already heard these great miraculous things that this man Jesus is doing. And he jumps off of this thing and lands out there in the yard and starts preaching again. I mean, that'd be pretty impressive, wouldn't it? People would be drawn to him. See, Satan wants to use your gifts for his glory and get you to quit glorifying the Lord. So he had been putting glory on himself and not pointing toward God. And the Lord said to him, Satan said to him, "Say, yeah, you just go ahead and do that. You can call these angels down. They'll rescue you." He was quoting Scripture even to Jesus, wasn't he? Oftentimes, if you're not careful, what your talents are can be your undoing. You're a great accountant. You know, you got a skill at that. You know how to do these figures. You know how to do the computer programs. You can do all that stuff. Guess what Satan can do to you? He can say to you, hey, take a shortcut. Man, you can make some money. Nobody will ever catch you because you got the talents. We knew a woman one time. She went to work at a bank, and she had worked for some time, and she got tied up with some other clerks, and some of them started telling her how she could take some money and never get caught at it. The only thing was she wasn't as good as some of the other ones. And she got caught. She took a shortcut. Satan always teaches young people to take a shortcut. He doesn't show you how it's going to end up. He just shows you the one side of the picture. He doesn't show the destruction that can happen to it. Then Satan said, hey, look here. Let me show you something else. Took him up on another place on a mountain somewhere. Some high mountain. Maybe it was Sinai. We really don't know. Showed him, looked around, said, you see over here? And started pointing out places. Maybe he said, see way over there? There's Egypt. See right down there? That's the Roman Empire right there. That's the Roman Empire. And started pointing to all these places. Jesus, you can have all that. Every bit of that, that can be yours. That power can be yours if you want it. But all you got to do is bow down and worship me. You know, I've heard stories. I used to listen to this old broadcast all the time called Coast to Coast on the AM dial. Man, I'd listen to all these booger stories. That's all they had on there was booger stuff, all kind of old stuff. And I'd listen to all that old stuff about ghosts and all that stuff. And man, once in a while, they'd get into some wild stuff. I even heard about people, honestly, who sold their soul to Satan. I mean, that's unreal, isn't it, somebody do that? Well, you know what? If you're not worshiping the living God, you're worshiping Satan. That's a reality. That's harsh, but if you're not walking with Jesus, you're walking with somebody else. If you're not walking in faith with Him, you have not aligned yourself with Him in faith. You're walking the other direction. But I'd listen to all that old coast-to-coast stuff. I have to tell this quick story right quick. I'm listening to all this stuff. I had a little paper out. Me and my number two son decides we're going to get rich. And the way we're going to get rich is delivering newspapers. Well, it didn't take long to find out the only rich thing he and I did was buy a Ford Ranger pickup truck. And that was it. After that, it was fun. It was one of the most fun jobs I've ever had in my life, to tell you the truth. I was in the middle of the night, about 2 or 3 in the morning, just riding around. I was over in Kannapolis, riding around one night, coast to coast is on, and somebody calls in and starts talking about demons. Ooh, ooh. And they said they looked out their window and they saw this thing with red eyes. And they're talking about it in their backyard. And they asked the host, said, "Do you think that's a demon?" And the fellow said, "Well, it sure sounds like it to me." Keeps going. And he said, "Where do you live?" He said, "Kannapolis, North Carolina." I went, "Golly bum. I'm telling you, I shut the radio down, and I mean, I'm a throwing papers. I didn't need that." See, that's really in a real way how Satan does. He gets our mind on other things, you know, gets us preoccupied. I wasn't with walking in the ways of the Lord, listening to all that old junk. I mean, I'm just feeding my spirit all this old crazy stuff. Jesus said, Satan said to Jesus, said, if you'll bow down and worship me, I'm going to give you all that. Now, what does Jesus say? What does Satan say to you? I mean, I don't know what that'd be that he says to you that you can have if you just follow him. He's probably more subtle to you than to me. He says, bow down and worship. He probably wouldn't use that kind of language to us. He probably just said, won't you do that? Won't you do this? Do that. That's the way he works. He's more cunning. I think I've told the story before. It was like on National Geographic or something one day. They showed these rangers somewhere in the savannah in Africa, and they're going through this field of high grass. And they're just going along in these three elephants. And somebody was filming them, looking back at them. And which is going to tell you what a dangerous place even that photographer was at, because in just a moment, without you ever realizing it, a tiger comes out of that high grass and jumps on the side of one of those elephants. You thought, wow, now he survives. And then they slowed all that down. And well, first then they say, now look again, and you're looking. You know that tiger's there. You don't even see him when he leaps back out again the second time. And then they slow it all down. They draw a circle in the grass. And that begins to move through the grass. And you see there's a tiger in that grass, which is wild to me. It's orange-like, you know. And here's this brown grass. And it just blends right in. And when they least expect it, it leaped. Peter says, be on your guard, because Satan is walking around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. See, he hides. He's cunning. He's not out there in the front. He's not out there in the front. Although, I'll be honest, he sure seems to be out in the front more than he's ever been before. And people still don't recognize him. Still don't recognize him. But he can destroy you when you least expect it. Now, what did Jesus say? Jesus said each time Satan started quoting Scripture back to him, Jesus replied with Scripture. And that is so important about why you and I need to study the Scriptures and apply it to our life. There is so many things that can discourage you and beat you down and rob you of your joy. I want to encourage you to get in the Word. He says we can't live by bread alone, but every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The very first temptation came his way. Now, I am a good illustration of this. I have not... Now, this is going to surprise some of you. This is absolutely going to blow your mind. I have not taken care of my body. I know that's so shocking. It's true. There have been times, instead of eating the country-style steak and the gravy and green beans and good stuff, you know what I'm saying? Instead, I go substituted at a Wendy's or a Taco Bell or you name the place, okay? Because it's fast. Now, it'll fill you up, won't it? It'll fill you up. It won't sustain you. Before I came in here, just about 10 minutes ago, I stopped at the house and I got me two peanut butter crackers and ate them because I need something in a little burst just to get me through dealing with y'all. So I did it. I don't know what medication you had to take, okay? But I just thought it'd be better for everybody if I didn't pass out. So I got that. And you know, before I left, there was a Fig Newton sitting there. I said, that might help me, and I got that too. We'll substitute something good for something bad. Every man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Now here comes the other kicker. We substitute good spiritual food for some that's maybe a little more junkified. if that's a language. Here's how that plays out. I, preacher, have my devotions every morning. Oh, do you? Yeah, I have my devotions every morning. I sit down with the upper room, I read that, and that's how I start my day. That's all right. But I'm going to tell you, or you get on the computer, you get that, and you go, listen, if you're not careful, you'll let that be junk spiritual food to you. You need to take time to really study His Word and what God's saying to you. It's not that the upper room's not good. It's not that you name daily bread, you name it. It's not that the computer programs are not good. That's okay. But are you taking time, because some human is telling you this stuff. Are you with me? Are you taking time to hear what God's Word that they quote, because they do? Are you taking time to get your Word and read the context of what that little smidgen is for you? Because if you don't, you're getting a little more junk stuff. You need to fill it with the Word of God. And so then you, not only do you need to fill it with the Word of God, but then you need to study it and you need to memorize it. Now, some of the best ways you can do it is you can take an old business card of somebody's and you can write the scripture down on the back of that business card. You can stick it in your pocket. You can stick it, tape it to your computer screen. You can tape it to your refrigerator, on your mirror when you're putting your war paint on. What have you got to do? And you begin to memorize that. Begin to memorize it and see what it's saying to you. And God will call that back to your memory and God will encourage you through it. If it blessed you when you first read it, why not put it in your heart that God will begin to touch you and nudge you with it? Hide His Word in your heart that you won't sin against Him. That's the best defense as you walk through this earth, because you are going to be tempted. You are going to go through trials. You are going to have difficult times, folks. That's the promise. Jesus went through them. And then the sidebar of the whole thing is, regardless of what somebody tells you, there is a force in this world that's evil. And there is one called Satan, the Satan. Jesus spoke about him. He must be real. If Jesus spoke about him and he's not real, you cannot follow Jesus. Because Jesus is a liar then. But he talked about him. If he's that real, that he thought it was important enough to talk about the evil one, it's important enough for you to know that that's your adversary. I was amazed not long after September 11th, we as a country, for some reason, it became unpopular to even mention about radical Islamic fundamentalists. We just pushed that aside, yet that was who the enemy was. Can you imagine in World War II that we quit naming the Nazis as our enemy? That's crazy. When you quit naming your enemy, folks, I don't care who you are, what you're about, when you quit naming the enemy, you're going to get deceived and you're going to be overwhelmed before long. Spiritually, you need to know that there is an adversary that does want to devour you. Jesus said, I come that you might have life and have it abundantly. John 10:10. Isn't that marvelous? Come to pour life out on us. Just lavish it on us. That's what Jesus came to do. Just lavish us with life. He's life-giving. But Satan comes to rob, kill, steal, and destroy. Jesus named him again. He put the light out on him about exactly what he tries to do. He robs life. Did you hear me? Anything or anybody that's against life is anti-God. And you need to remember that. He's life-giving. Do you know him? Do you know the one that's life-giving that really wants to pour out his life on you? Well, young people, if you don't know him, and you old folks, if you don't know him, hey, today you need to say, Lord, forgive me of my sin. I want to follow you and walk with you. Any of you young people want to do that? You want to walk with Jesus, any of you? Never give your life to Jesus. This morning, you need to do that. We're going to bow our heads. We're going to have a prayer. And I'm going to pray with you, okay? All over this place. If you've never asked Jesus in your heart, you ought to ask Him today. If you've never asked Him to save your soul, you need to ask Him. The journey of spiritual life begins with putting Jesus first and asking Jesus into our life. We will fail, no doubt, but Jesus will help us pick us up. We won't stay down long. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for these young people. Lord, we've heard your voice today. And guys, all over this place, I want you to pray with me. Pray out loud, everybody. Dear Lord, I need you. I know I'm a sinner. Thank you that you want to give me life. I want to take that life and walk with you in Jesus' name. Thank you for forgiving me of my sin. Amen. Thank you. Well, if you prayed that prayer and you meant that prayer, Jesus has come into your heart. If you've done that for the first time in your life, you ought to tell somebody that today you've decided to walk with Jesus. Tell somebody. Tell somebody, young people, okay? You tell somebody. If you've never done that, you need to tell a mom or dad so they can help you in your Christian walk. Amen.
Stand as we sing Freely, Freely.
Watermark in the life of the church. When somebody joins a church, that's an important day. And I want to bring Laura up and Sylvia and stop it, Lynn. It was coming to me. I forgot her name Wednesday night, so now I can't remember Lynn's either. So we're so glad to have these dear folks with us as they're coming. And they came, all of them, by the way. After COVID, they came this past, after June of this year. So we're so glad how you came before that. Laura did. So anyway, and I asked Laura, I wanted her to share with you about why she came to this church and what's on her mind today.
Well, you might learn in the months and the years ahead that if you give me a chance to talk, I love to talk. But there's my friend, my dear friend Patty and Warren and Rachel, and they brought me here. And when the lockdown started, and I live by myself and I work from home, and I just felt like, oh my goodness, I'm here in this bubble and I don't have anywhere to go and anything to do and anybody to talk to. I could go days and not hear the sound of another human voice. But Patty was just wonderful because Patty had texted me about once every day or so, how are you doing? Are you doing okay? And then she texted me a clip of Pastor Mitch inviting people to come to drive-in church. And I said to Patty, I said, well, I think I might want to do that. And Patty said, well, Warren and I are going to start singing at drive-in church. And I love to hear Patty and Warren sing. And I said, well, I'll come. And the thing that touched me so much was at the end, as everybody was driving away in their car, they came around the portico, and Pastor Mitch was waving goodbye. And there was this wonderful sense that I'd been invited to your house, and then Pastor Mitch was, and the others that were standing there and waving goodbye, it was like they were saying, we're so glad you've come. And then I knew that I could go back home and go back in the bubble and live by myself and, you know, just, you know, exist for another 6 days, and then Sunday would roll around and I'd come back to church. But it meant so much to me. So I shared that with Pastor Mitch last week, and he asked that I share that story with you. So anyway, I'm just thrilled to be here.
Thank you. Thank you. We're so glad to have you. Y'all want to say anything? Okay, you want to say anything?
For those of you who don't know, Lynn retired from the Methodist ministry at the end of June, and then we moved up here. But today is the first time in 35 years that we got to pick our church. Yep. And we picked y'all because of Mitch and what we experienced when we came here to visit. So from the bottom of my hearts, thank you. We came because we chose this, not because the bishop sent us. So thanks.
What? I didn't hear that coming. I'll be in the Congo somewhere riding an elephant. I'm going to ask you, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Will you support the church by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? We want to welcome them, our new brothers and sisters here at the family. So let's stand, and we're going to sing a verse of Amazing Grace, and then our scouts are going to, I think that's right? Okay.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Amen. Now somebody's going to have a prayer. I want to say thank you to all of you, and I so appreciate these scouts leading us today. I tell you what, now you all, I want you to know what a difference you make. Today I thought, I don't want to go do this all again today. And I'm not talking about y'all, just the whole thing. And when I went over to Arcadia, I changed the whole sermon and preached a whole different sermon. Man, they liked it. They got out in 30 minutes today. And then I knew that I was going to come here and be something fresh, and I just thank you. Thank you so much. Have we been blessed today? Thank you all so much. We'll get them out on the portico, and you can wave at them out at the portico as y'all leave out if you want to, if y'all want to do that. Thank you. Thank you.
And the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Have a great week. Amen.